Welcome to Civil Services Achievers Point. We are discussing today the Assam Tribune of 25 September 2020. At Civil Services Achievers Point, we have various courses. You can join these courses. For details, you can call at the number given below. You can also follow us on the social media platforms. This Assam Tribune analysis is based on the new pattern of APSC. It is also useful for UPSC and other state level government examinations. These are the answers to the MCQs of 24 September. You can pause the video here and check out the answers. These are the MCQs of 25 September 2020. Students are advised to pause the video here and attempt these questions. And you can mention the answers in the comment section below. These MCQs are highly probable in the upcoming APSC prelims examination. So students, please consider these MCQs as very important. So these are the important newspaper articles we are discussing today from the Assam Tribune and the important editorials. So let us begin with the news articles. The first news article is very, very important. Guwahati Tea Auction Center turns 50 years. So this may be a MCQ based question in the upcoming prelims examination. So they will ask in the year in which the Guwahati Tea Auction Center was established. So the answer is 1970. So this is a highly probable question in the upcoming prelims exam. Students, kindly make a note of it. This can also be studied under the General Studies 5 paper or the GS on Assam paper in mains topic economic development. So on 25 September 1970, the then chairman of the Assam Tea Brokers, R.G. Borua, had hammered down the first lot of tea. That is 1,317 kg of broken orange pekoe of Horusarai Tea Estate. So this may also be asked as a MCQ as one of the points in the prelims. The tea estate name is Horusarai, and which was bought by tea trader Zafar Ali for a rupees of 42.50 kg. So this is the history of the Guwahati Tea Auction Center. So students, APSC will definitely check this point in the prelims examination. And with this auction in 1970, it began a new era in the Assam's tea industry with the launch of Guwahati Tea Auction Center. Now, the Tea Auction Center, which turns 50 years old, is the second highest selling center among 12 auction centers of the world. So among 12 such centers, the second highest selling center is the Guwahati Tea Auction Center. So this is another very important point. Now coming to the next important topic. So this is another important article regarding the RBI approach to deal with cybersecurity issues. So as we know, there is an increasing cybersecurity threat in the banking sector. So RBI has prescribed 5 pillared approach to deal the issues of cybersecurity. And this topic we will study under the General Studies 3 paper, Economic Development. So the background is that the Reserve Bank of India has come out with a 5 pillared strategic approach. And they have given a name to the approach called GUARD. G-U-A-R-D. So it is abbreviated as Governance Oversight, Utile Technology Investment, Appropriate Regulation and Supervision, Robust Collaboration, and Developing Necessary IT and Cybersecurity Skill Sets. So APSC has a tendency of asking the full form of government schemes or any initiative. So definitely a prelims based MCQ question can be expected regarding the ऑब्जेक्टिव एंड द फुल फॉर्म ऑफ द अप्रोच, फाइव पिलर अप्रोच. एपीएससी में आस्क व्हाट आर द फाइव पिलर्स ऑफ द आरबीआई प्रेस्क्राइब अप्रोच टू डील विद साइबर सिक्योरिटी इश्यूज. सो दिस इज डन बिकॉज द नंबर, फ्रीक्वेंसी एंड इम्पैक्ट ऑफ ए साइबर इंसिडेंट्स and attacks have increased manifold in the recent past, more so in the case of the financial sector, that is the urban cooperative banks. So RBI has released a document which is called Technology Vision for Cyber Security for Urban Cooperative Banks 2020 to 2023. So the objective of the report or the document is that it has become essential to enhance the security posture of the urban cooperative banks to prevent, detect, respond to and recover from the cyber attack. So the objective is to first of all prevent, then detect and respond and recover from the cyber attacks. So students, this is very important from our upcoming prelims examination. The technology vision document, which was formalized from taking inputs from various stakeholders, it is aimed at enhancing the cyber security posture of UCBs, that is the urban commercial urban cooperative banks, against the newly arising IT and cyber threats. The 12 specific action points which are suggested in the document, these include more broad oversight over cybersecurity, enabling the urban cooperative banks to better manage and secure their IT assets, and also setting of offsite supervisory mechanism framework on cybersecurity and their concern control. So it not only involves the prevention and detection of the cyber threats, but also developing an overall supervisory mechanism framework on cybersecurity issues. Now coming to the next important development, this is regarding our security forces. So the government is planning to withdraw border forces from the internal law and order duties. So this is we can discuss in the general studies 3 paper topic security. So the central government is working on a plan to gradually withdraw border guarding forces like the BSF, the Indo-Tibetan Border Police Force and the Sashastra Sima Bal, the SSB, from internal security duties, so that to strengthen protection at various frontiers of the country. So we know that as per one border, one security force formula, we have the BSF in the Pakistan, in the Indo-Pakistan and Indo-Bangladesh border, the ITBP along the Indo-China border, and the SSB along the Indo-Nepal and Indo-Bhutan border. And we have the Assam Rifles along the Indo-Myanmar border. So the government is planning to gradually withdraw border forces guarding the frontier areas from the internal security duties. The Ministry of Home Affairs is working on a new model where the burden of internal security duties, including conduct of elections, will be largely borne by the country's largest paramilitary force, the Central Reserve Police Force, that is the CRPF. So the Ministry of Home Affairs has drafted a model where the burden of the internal security duties will be largely borne by the country's largest paramilitary force, that is the Central Reserve Police Force. The 3.2 lakh strong CRPF is already designated as the lead internal security force of the country. So, as per a security establishment officer, a new experiment will be put in place during the forthcoming elections in Bihar and by polls in some states where the CRPF will be deployed in a 70-30 ratio along with the state police forces. So in a 70-30 ratio, 70% CRPF and 30% the state police for the conduction of the state elections and the bipoles. The CRPF will be overall security in charge during conduct of polls, and the border guarding forces like the Border Security Force, the Indo-Tibetan Border Police Force and the Sashastra Sima Bal will be gradually withdrawn from these duties so as to these forces can only focus on the border guarding roles. So this will enable the border guarding forces to strengthen their respective fronts, including by operationalizing more posts. So we have to operationalize more posts and reducing the gap between the post distance. So to increase the border security, the internal security will be largely given to the CRPF. Now coming to the next important topic, nuclear scientist Shekhar Basu passed away. Now APSC will ask regarding whenever any famous or eminent personalities are deceased, then APSC has a tendency to ask about their contribution or in which field they belong to. So APSC may form a MCQ in the prelims exam that Shekhar Basu was a scientist or a literary person, educationist or an environmentalist. They will give certain points. We have to know that he was a nuclear scientist. So this point is very important. Students, please make a note of this point. Veteran atomic scientist and former chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission, Dr. Shekhar Basu, has succumbed to the COVID-19 on Thursday at a private hospital, and he breathed his last just 3 days after turning 68. So he was a mechanical engineer, and he is also remembered for his contributions to the country's atomic energy program, and he was awarded the Padma Shri in 2014. So this is another important point. He was awarded the Padma Shri in 2014. Dr. Basu also pioneered the highly complex reactor for India's first nuclear powered submarine, INS Arihant. So this is another important point. So he was born on September 20, 1952, and did his schooling from the Billigans Government School and then graduated in mechanical engineering from Veer Mata Jijabai Technological Institute, University of Mumbai in 1974. So whenever any eminent personalities are passes away, then questions on them are generally expected both in APSC and also in UPSC. Now, let us students discuss the important editorials of today's newspaper. The first editorial of today's newspaper is the dress rehearsal, that is a statement given by the Secretary General of the United Nations. So the paper is General Studies 3 paper, topic technology and environment. So the Secretary General of the United Nations, Antonio Guterres, addressing the 75th session of the UN General Assembly, said that the COVID-19 pandemic is not only a wake-up call, but a dress rehearsal for more challenges to come. So, in an interconnected world, it was high time to recognize the simple truth that solidarity was self-interest. So cooperation was the best interest of all. And if we give in to populism and nationalism in this time, then everybody will be losing. And this comment comes in reaction to the comments made by Donald Trump about protecting the US citizens and about the nationalism propagated by Russia and to some extent China also. Because in such a pandemic like condition, countries which are not economically stable or strong, they have received too little assistance. So the Secretary General has urged the 193 member states of the UN to move forward together in the face of the disease, and he also observed that humanity must be guided by science and tethered to reality, because attempts to contain the virus through populism and nationalism. So some countries are trying to play the populism and nationalism card, have made the situation worse, and he made this in reference to the US President Donald Trump. The Secretary General also pointed out that the pandemic has exposed the inequalities and the fragilities across the globe and generated an epochal health crisis, the biggest economic and job losses since the Great Depression. So he has compared the economic condition in the current pandemic situation with the Great Depression of 1920s. The Great Depression was an era of in the USA in the 1920s, just after the First World War. So the Secretary General compared the economic condition with the Great Depression era. And he further said that this is a dangerous new threat to human rights. So he also said that the earth has seen many pandemics or many diseases, spreading of diseases. However, this time it is different, because those had not caused the ravage which this novel coronavirus has inflicted so far and threatens to inflict in the future unless a safe and effective vaccine is developed. So he further said that today, with communication being advanced and planet Earth has been reduced to a global village due to the globalization, endemics more readily convert to pandemics as the number of international travelers increases and diverse people from diverse climes rub shoulders with each other. So what the Secretary General has said, that whenever there is an outbreak, the outbreak turns to an endemic when it is limited to a specific area or a country, and then it becomes the pandemic, means it spreads to multiple countries, because there are international goods and services and also people traveling from one nation to another. Also, we are suffering from region-specific epidemics like the plague or the Ebola, and these diseases have been contained through strict protocols. So without doubt, the Secretary General has rightly emphasized on that newer viruses and other diseases will come in future, and because of greater interconnectivity enlarged into pandemics. So these diseases may turn to pandemics, and the learnings during this rehearsal period of coronavirus will equip us better to fight them in the future. So this is a very good way how essays can be ended, because the author in the editorial has ended the editorial on coronavirus pandemic with a positive note. It is difficult to end. It is certain in certain cases it is not easy to end on positive notes in, say, dealing with coronavirus pandemics. But despite those limitations, the author has ended in positive note. So this is how essays are, or rather GS answers are, ended with a certain degree of positivity. Now coming to the next important editorial, earthquake damage mitigation and civic bodies. So this editorial discusses the dangers or the damages caused by the earthquake and the mitigation process taken by the civic bodies. And this we can study under the General Studies 3 paper, topic disaster management. So the author discusses that the structures in the cities and towns in the country are in control of the civic bodies like the municipal corporations, councils, municipality boards, town committees and others. So these civic bodies regulate new construction activities within their jurisdiction. However, the earthquakes of the recent past, such as those of Latur in Gujarat or Bhuj and Manipur, have already shown the extent of loss of life and property. And an earthquake of the type of 1950 in Assam with a magnitude of 8.6 in Northeast region is due anytime. So the civic bodies of our regions are have to develop or be ready for any challenges which come due to the earthquakes. And the government of India has recently taken a project called National Seismic Risk Mitigation Program. So this is another a very important point for prelims and mains perspective, because in mains, disaster management is a direct topic in our GS3 paper. So students, please make a note of it. Also, the adoption of mitigation measures is necessary in view of the fact that number one, there are many unauthorized structures violating the rules and regulations well laid down in bylaws, and there are many structures vulnerable to earthquake damages. So first, there is the identification of vulnerable structures. We'll obviously need the services of experts with specialized knowledge on areas which include planning, structural design, testing of materials, construction techniques, etc. A list of vulnerable buildings may then be prepared along with the names of the owners, which will include government, semi-government organizations, private organizations and individuals. So this is another important point. So this task is feasible under the guidance and assistance of the State Disaster Management Authority, empowered by the Disaster Management Act of the country. Now, it may run into the range. We should know that there is a particular vulnerable structure may be identified by the experts, as we have mentioned here, and the cost necessary for implementation of the retrofit measures may be substantial. So for reconstruction of the structures which are damaged in earthquake, the cost may be very substantial. And to make it worse, the Northeast region happens to be one of the 6 severe most earthquake prone zones of the world, and it has the highest zone factor of 0.36 in the country. And the actions initiated by the government of Assam and some other Northeastern states relate to heritage structures and government structures vulnerable to earthquake damages. So the author in the editorial discusses that it will require a concerted effort from all stakeholders to act towards mitigation of earthquake damages in vulnerable structures, thereby avoiding a likely situation of human tragedy as which are led by the earthquakes of the past. So with these students, we come to an end today's kind of a class. I hope this video was very helpful. You can attempt the MCQs which we have provided in the initial slides and comment in the comment section below. Thank you for watching the video. Thank you.